Dear friends, welcome to the 8th lecture on exposure models and design methods under the module of accident modeling, risk assessment and management in HSC course at NPTEL IIT Madras. Before we look into the exposure models and design methods, let us try to quickly recollect the different damage estimates for explosion. Explosions result in a blast or a pressure wave moving out from explosion center, and the velocity of this motion will be approximately equal to that of speed of sound. Shock waves or overpressure is the basic cause for such damages caused by explosion. Missiles or projectiles are other important source of damage which are caused by explosion. Damage, of course, rate of function of rate of pressure increase and duration of the blast wave. Blast damages are estimated based on the overpressure on the peak side of the explosion damage. Look at the curve presented in the slide now. Explosion actually release generates a rapid rise in pressure. So, from the atmospheric, the pressure rises to what we call as P naught, which is called peak over pressure in an instantaneous time from T0 to T1. Subsequently, after P0 is reached, the pressure drops down and it goes to suction pressure below atmospheric before it comes to the atmospheric pressure. So, the damage caused by the explosion is area under this curve. The propagating wave causes damage to objects located on its path. It is then followed by a negative pressure wave which causes further damage before the pressure wave returns to atmospheric. Therefore, the damage depends on the maximum pressure reached, which is P naught, velocity of propagation and environmental characteristics, and therefore, it is very simple for us to realize that area under this curve of P versus time will give me the measure of severity that arises from an explosion. Now, the question comes how to estimate exposure damages. There are many methods available in the literature, out of which one of the most popular method is called TNT equivalence method. Let us quickly understand what is TNT, then how to find equivalence from TNT to estimate the damage arise from different exposure models. What is TNT? TNT is trinitrotoluene, an important explosive which has got a chemical composition as shown in the slide now. The chemical composition has got components of the component shown in the figure now, whereas the black powder, which is the residual result from TNT, is otherwise called as soot in the literature. So, this is the chemical composition of a TNT, and this is a black powder results from TNT. TNT has got a very interesting characteristic. It can quickly change from solid to hot expanding gases. TNT is an explosive fundamentally for two reasons. One, it contains elements of carbon, oxygen and nitrogen, which means that when it burns, it produces highly stable substances with strong bond with each other. TNT explosions are chemically unstable, which means that it does not require much force to break their bond. Now, we are interested in looking at a mass equivalence of TNT, which can be converted to an equivalent damage caused by the explosion. So, step number 1, try to determine the total mass of fuel involved. So, in this equation, M denotes the total mass of any explosive fuel which is involved in causing a damage. Step number 2, estimate the explosion efficiency eta. This efficiency generally varies from 1% to 15% in the literature. In step number 3, determine the energy of explosion delta H c. Delta H c for every chemical which is explosive is available readily in the gas explosion handbook. Now, we should also know the value ETNT, which is the energy of explosion of TNT, which can be taken as 4686 kilojoules per kilogram. So, once we have all these values available, I will get mass equivalent of TNT, which is an equivalent mass as that of the mass participating in the explosion. Once I get the TNT equivalent mass, I substitute here to get Ze, where Ze is called the scaled distance and R is the distance from the explosion site to the point of concern. So once I have the r value substituted in this equation, I will get the scaled distance ZD, which can be computed from the equation on the right side. Once the scale distance is known to me, looking at this curve, I can estimate what we call scaled over pressure, which is PS. So one can use this figure readily to obtain PS, or alternatively one can also find the over pressure value from the equation given below. So if I know the over pressure value, I can always find, which is the product of PS and P atmospheric. PS is the scaled over pressure available from the chart, which can be read from the figure directly, and P of course is the atmospheric pressure. Alternatively, P naught can also be obtained from the equation given below, where ZD are the required to be substituted in this equation. Remaining all values are known to us. Therefore, after determining the over pressure using the table, one can estimate the damage cost. The table clearly shows here, for a given value of over pressure in kilopascal, what would be equivalent damage which is available in the literature. So the equivalent over pressure in kilopascal varies from 0.28 to as high as 75, clearly causes relative damages as a simple loud noise which can result in breakage of glass, which is caused, which is equivalent to 143 decibels. As high as 90% probability of human fatality can result when the over pressure damage can be as high as 75 kilopascal. So ladies and gentlemen, it is very important for us to first convert the given value of mass TNT equivalence to over pressure, which can be simply computed from this equation or from this equation. For using this equation, I must know PS, which can be taken directly from the chart. For obtaining PS from this chart, I must know ZD, whereas ZD is available from this equation directly if you know mass TNT. So one of the most popular method available in the literature is mass equivalence of TNT, if you know the mass participating of the explosive in the given damage. So ZD is a local value which depends on what is the distance of your point of concern from the point of explosion site. So once I have the overpressure value, using this table I can equally find out the damage cost from the overpressure value caused by the explosion. Other alternative methods are developed based on the degree of congestion or confinement. The basis is that confinement leads to turbulence, which increases the burning velocity. TNO multi-energy model is another alternative available in the literature, which can also help us to find out the damage arising from the explosions. Alternate method again available in the literature is the Baker-Stelhov model, which can be used directly to estimate the damages from overpressure. Friends, we also know that energy in the explosions also a very important reason for creating damages, especially in chemical explosions. Energy released during a reaction can be computed directly using standard thermodynamics law. Heat of combustion is used to assess the explosion strength. Studies show that the explosion energy differs only by over 10% from the heat of combustion. Therefore, the explosion energy can be directly used as an indicative measure to find out the damage caused by the chemical explosions. Explosion energy of course can also arise from physical explosions. In mechanical or physical explosions, of course a reaction does not occur as that occurs in chemical reaction. Energy in this case is released directly from the contained substance. There are four approaches available in the literature, namely Brodt's method, isentropic expansion method, isothermal expansion method, thermodynamics law. We can use these corresponding equations for finding out the energy which is released because of the physical explosions. We are using an isotropic method or an isothermal or Brodt's equation. In this equation, where E is the explosion energy, P1 available in the equation is the atmospheric pressure, and P2 of course is the overbursting pressure which is resulting from the explosion. V is the volume of the vessel, and nu is the heat capacity ratio used in the equation. Alternatively, we can also have explosions resulting from dust and gas expansions. For a gas, molecules are small and are well defined in size. Alternatively, for a dust particle, size is larger in magnitude in many order compared to that of the gas molecules. Gravity also plays a very important effect, because the dust particles' behavior is significantly affected by the gravitational pressure. The equations available here for estimating the pressure in bar that arise from the pressure gradient or the pressure differential, as shown here, is a function of kg and kst, where kg is called deflagration index and kst is called the deflation index for the gas and dust respectively, which can be given by this, and where V is the volume of expansion available in the container. The deflagration can raise pressure up to 8 times, whereas detonation can raise pressure even more than this value. Rate of pressure rise, which is called dP/dt, is also an important factor which plays role to estimate the damages caused by the energy release in case of explosions. This of course depends on the characteristics of the fuel mixture and the way in which the explosion is contained. Now let us look into some of the design criteria based on which we can contain or confine these explosions. Three conditions, as we all understand, are required for fire or combustion explosion: presence of combustible material, oxygen to support the combustible reaction, and source of ignition to initiate the reaction. Lack of any one of the three conditions of the fire triangle shall make the fire or combustion impossible. The design criteria therefore to prevent fire and explosion is that: prevent flammable mixture, reduce ignition sources, reduce inventories which can cause ignition, and control operating temperature and pressure. Let us now look at the list of preventive measures which can be adopted in the industry for preventing fire and explosions. Following strategies are commonly used in the industry: inerting and purging, which means reduced oxygen content or fuel concentration below a specific target value. You can also use a flammability diagram by which you can control three important elements of fire and explosion. You can also use controlling the static electricity as one of the strategy for preventing fire and explosion. Reduce the existence of ignition source in the given system. Provide enough ventilation, which can be achieved by diluting the flammable mixture by adding more air in the content. Use explosion proof equipments and instruments in the industry, and of course use sprinkler systems to control if fire or explosion occurs. Let us look into these design methods one by one in detail. Inerting and purging is a process by which you reduce the oxygen content or the fuel concentration to a level lower than the limiting oxygen concentration. To do this, one generally uses an inert gas. Nitrogen, carbon dioxide and others can be commonly used, but however, nitrogen is most popularly used for inerting operations. Commonly used control point is 4% below the limiting oxygen concentration. If you look at the purging methods, one can have different methods available in literature: vacuum purging, pressure purging, combined purging, vacuum and pressure purging with impure nitrogen, and sweep through purging. In case of vacuum purging, we evacuate and replace with inert gas completely. In case of pressure purging, we pressurize with inert gas and then release the pressure from the given system. Ultimately, we can also do what is called siphon purging. We will see one by one very quickly. In case of vacuum purging, let us see this figure available in the screen now. Initially, it is one of the most commonly used method for inerting procedure for contained vessels. The procedure is very simple: drawing vacuum on the vessel, relieve the vacuum with inert gas, repeat the cycle until desired concentration is reached. So the pressure needs to be dropped from high value to lower value desired for the specific range. So while you are dropping the pressure or increasing the pressure, one has to maintain the oxygen concentration as a constant value, while the mole oxygen content is also remained to be constant. Therefore, the concentration keeps on changing from Y0 to Y1 to Y2 as the number of cycles are changed from A to B and C and so on as the time progresses. Initial oxygen concentration under vacuum, which is Y naught, is the same as the initial concentration available in the fuel. Number of moles at high initial high pressure pH and initial low pressure PL are computed for an ideal gas behavior. Once it is known, then NH and NL are in the equation available as total moles in the atmospheric and vacuum states respectively. So for every concentration, once you know the oxygen participation and the total moles, one can always try to compute what is the concentration available at every level of change in the different cycle as Y1, Y2 and so on. One can easily understand, friends, for finding out the concentration at Y1, you need to know the value of Y0. Similarly, for finding out the value of Y2, you need to know the value of Y1. So it is the subsequent step of purging which is done with the help of these equations. The number of moles for oxidants are calculated using Dalton's law. At the end of the first cycle, the new oxidant, which is the lower concentration, is Y1, where Y1 is the oxygen concentration after the first purge with Y2. As you keep on purging, you will see that the concentration changes from Y0 to Y1 and subsequently to Y2 and so on. Similarly, at the end of the second cycle, the oxygen concentration is now given by Y2 and so on. Therefore, for the ith cycle, the oxygen concentration Yi can be given by this equation, which depends on Y0 as well as the pressure drop for the ith cycle. The total mass added to each cycle is therefore constant. For I cycles, the total nitrogen gas moles is given by delta N2, which is given by this equation available on the right hand side of this equation in the slide. One can also do pressure purging. In this case, from the lower pressure value, the pressure is increased with the concentration changing from Y0 to Y1 and so on, as you see here. While you are increasing the pressure, moles oxygen is kept constant and the concentration is also maintained constant during the drop as well as pressure rise in number of cycles, as you see in the picture. Vessels can be pressure purged by adding inert gas under pressure. Subsequently, added gas is diffused throughout the vessel and vented to atmosphere. The initial concentration of oxygen in the vessel Y0, which is seen here, is computed after the vessel is pressurized. The number of moles for the pressurized state is NH and that of the atmospheric is NL. The oxygen concentration at the ith cycle Yi is given by the ratio of PL versus pH for I cycles with that of the initial value Y0. One can also do combined purging, pressure and vacuum purging, as you see in the slide now. Both pressure and vacuum purging are used simultaneously to purge a vessel. Competition procedure depends on whether the vessel is first evacuated or pressurized. Let us say, for example, let us do the pressurizing first. In that case, beginning of the cycle is first defined as the end of the initial pressurization. The concentration Y0 is given by this value, which is 0.21 of that of oxygen constant with P0 and pH value known to us. The oxygen mole fraction at this point is same as that of the initial mole fraction available in the fuel. Remaining cycles are identical to the pressure purging operation because you have pressurized it first. If the initial oxygen mole fraction is 0.21, then the oxygen mole fraction at the end of the initial pressurization is given by the equation as you see in the slide now. Therefore, for ith cycle after initial pressurization, the concentration is given by this equation as you see here. If one decides to evacuate first, beginning of the cycle is defined as the end of the initial evacuation. So you evacuate first and maintain the mole oxygen is constant and improve or change the concentration from Y0 to Y1 and so on. As you see, friends, in the previous case, you initially pressurize, then evacuate or purge, whereas in this case, you first evacuate and then pressurize. So it is a combination of pressure and evacuation, as you see in the previous examples. The beginning of the cycle is defined as the end of the initial evacuation, and the oxygen mole fraction at this point is same as that of the initial mole fraction, and for the subsequent cycles of yi the remaining cycles are identical to the vacuum pressure purging. For I plus 1th cycle the value of concentration can be given as you see in the equation here. One can also do pressure and vacuum purging with impure purging. For a pressure purging, total moles of oxygen at the end of the first pressurization, the sum of moles initially present and those included with the nitrogen, which can be given by the equation available in the literature now, where the number of oxygen moles concentration is given by the initial concentration with this equation plus the oxygen concentration available between the pressure difference as given by this relationship. Mole fraction of oxygen at the end of the first cycle is therefore given by the n oxygen computed from the previous slide as you see here divided by n total, which is again the relationship of as you see in the figure here. Now one can generalize this equation. The oxygen concentration at the end of the ith pressure cycle is therefore given by the relationship as you see in the equation in the slide now. Now one can compare the pressure and vacuum purging and see what are the merits and demerits. Pressure purging is of course faster because pressure differentials are greater and activated faster. Pressure purging uses more inert gas than the vacuum purging. Vacuum purging uses less inert gas because the oxygen concentration is reduced primarily by vacuum and not by nitrogen replacement. Alternatively, one can also do what is called sweep through purging. This purging process adds purge gas into a vessel at one opening and withdraws the mixed gas from the other end of the vessel in the other opening. This is generally used when the vessel or equipment is not rated for pressure or vacuum purging. The mass balance of oxygen in this case is given by the equation shown in the slide now. Hence the volumetric quantity of inert gas required to do oxygen concentration from C1 to C2 is given by QVT, which is given with the equation as you see in the slide now here. One can also do siphon purging as one of the design methods for reducing damages caused by explosion. The sweep through purging requires large quantity of nitrogen. This could be expensive when purging is done on a large storage vessel. In such cases people generally go for siphon purging, which reduces the expenditure because of purging. Purging process starts by filling the vessel with liquid. This liquid may be either water or any other compatible liquid with that of the vessel. Siphon purging, in this case the purged gas is subsequently added to the vapor space as liquid is drained from the vessel. Volume of purged gas is equal to the volume of the vessel. Rate of purging is of course equivalent to the volumetric rate of liquid discharge from the vessel. Alternatively, friends, one can also use flammability diagrams to prevent explosion and fire. Objective is to avoid flammable region. The flammability diagram determines whether the flammable mixture exists and provides target concentration for inerting and purging. One can also use a technique called placing a vessel out of service. So let us look at the flammability diagram here. We recollect this, it has got three arms, nitrogen, fuel arm and the oxygen arm. The values varying from 0 to 100, 0 to 100 and 0 to 100 in anti-clockwise manner. We know how to draw this particular flammability diagram. In this case the diagram is shown for a fuel which is methane. Objective of the diagram is to avoid the flammable region. We already know the flammable region is going to be this part, which can be plotted easily depending upon the LOC and LFL and UFL of the fuel arm. The gas concentration is the points R and M are known to me because these are the concentration available to me readily. The composition of this at the point S can be computed using this equation. So one can keep the out of service in the vessel by using this concentration, where OSFC stands for out of service fuel concentration. The fuel concentration point is collected as point S because that is on the fuel arm. So one would like to know this value because I want to keep the vessel out of service in terms of this fuel concentration. LFL of course is the volume of percentage of fuel in air percent of oxygen, and LOC is the limiting oxygen concentration in volume percent of oxygen. And of course, we know in this equation Z is the stoichiometric oxygen coefficient from the combustion reaction of the fuel. One can also place the vessel back into service. So, I would like to know again the concentration available. The composition is point S now is given by this equation available in the screen, where in this case ISOC stands for in service oxygen concentration in terms of volume percentage, LFL of course the volume of fuel in percent of oxygen, LOC is the limiting oxygen concentration volume of percent oxygen, and so on, and Z of course is the stoichiometric oxygen coefficient available for the specific fuel in terms of its reaction. Therefore, the nitrogen concentration at point S is equal to 100 minus ISOC, where ISOC can be computed from this relationship. There are other methods parallel available in the literature, which is given by NFPA 69 recommendations. NFPA 69 is Standards and Explosion Prevention Systems. A target oxygen concentration for storage vessels should not exceed 2% below the measured LOC if oxygen concentration is continuously monitored. If it is not, then it can be 5% of the target value. If the oxygen concentration is not continuously monitored, the equipment must not operate at more than 60% LOC or 40% of LOC if LOC is below 5% available. These are recommendations given by the Standards and Explosion Prevention Systems, is practiced in oil and gas industries. Friends, alternatively one can also use explosion proof equipments, which are rated as XP equipments. The explosion proof equipments are designed not to prevent entry flammable vapors or gases, but to withstand internal pressure and prevent combustion from these actions. Area and material classification can be done basically as explosion equipment proof. There are different class systems available in the literature. There are different group systems available. There are different divisions available in the systems, which we will see one by one. Class systems are related to the nature of flammable material. Class 1, 2, and 3 respectively show where flammable gases and vapors are present. Class 2 shows locations where flammable dust is present. Class 3 shows hazard locations where combustible fibers or dust are present, but not likely to be in suspension. When you talk about grouping of the systems, groups are based on the designate of the presence of specific chemical type. Chemicals having equivalent hazards are grouped, group A, B, C, and so on. A grouped as acetylene, B hydrogen and ethylene, group C stands for carbon dioxide and hydrogen sulfide, group D butane, ethane, and ethyl alcohol, group E aluminium dust, group F is carbon black, group G is fluor. You can also have division systems as recommended by the guidelines given in OSID. Divisions are made in relationship with the probability of material being within the flammable or explosive region. Division 1 stands for the probability of ignition is very high, flammable concentration is normally present. Division 2 stands for hazard is only at abnormal conditions, the flammable materials are normally contained in a closed containers or given system, and so on. Lastly, sprinkler systems can also be one of the effective design methodologies to prevent or reduce damages caused from explosions. There are different types of sprinkler systems available in the literature. Anti-freeze sprinkler system, which is defined as a wet pipe system that contains an anti-freeze solution and is connected to the water supply system. You can also have a deluge sprinkler system, which consists of open sprinklers and an empty line that is connected to the water supply line through a valve. The valve is open upon detection of heat and flammable material and water sprinkled inside. Dry pipe sprinkler system indicates a system filled with nitrogen or air under pressure. When sprinkler is opened by heat, system is depressurized and allows water to flow into the system. You can also have wet sprinkler system, which contains water discharges through the open sprinklers via heat. So sprinkler designs can also be done. One should aim at the minimum quantity of water required at a specific pressure available from the literature as a guideline. They are based on NFPA recommendations. NFPA standards are for explosion prevention systems. The quantity of water, which is given in meter cube per second, and the corresponding pressure requirement in terms of Newton millimeter square is given as a guideline for designing the sprinkler systems, ladies and gentlemen. So, as per the NFPA norms, nominal discharge rate for 12.5 mm orifice spray nozzle is given in the table as shown in the figure. So, friends, in this lecture we discussed about different exposure models and corresponding design methods by which we can either mitigate or reduce the damages caused from the explosions of different nature. We have also seen some of the guidelines given by the directorate. We have also seen some of the parallel methods by which the mitigation can be achieved in terms of damages caused from explosion. Most importantly, to estimate the damage arising from explosion, we have found out the TNT equivalence method, which is most commonly used in the literature for oil and gas industries. Thank you very much.